Okay, folks. Listen, I get the most requests for this next guest than I get really for anybody. And I've gotten so many emails, DMs, messages since the last time he was on, which was at Thanksgiving. Wow. Just checking in about how he's doing, what's going on. And, you know, luckily we have the pleasure of having him in Los Angeles this weekend. So the one and only Bill Bailey, welcome back to the show.
Hi, good to be back.
You're back.
I hope everybody had a good holiday.
Yeah, no, we were going to do this at Christmas, but things were a little crazy. Things were a little crazy.
A little crazy.
So I guess the first thing where they left you off last time is I had made you a hard sandwich on an Italian roll and you broke off your tooth.
Yeah.
And you now have you went to the dentist and they took two other teeth out,
yeah,
right?
So I got a partial, three teeth, partial. Here, let me take them out.
Yeah, by the way, he now has like three teeth that he takes in and out.
It's really weird. Any of you have been through it? Very weird. So, and the other, my only advice to you is don't eat a sandwich that Ryan makes.
don't eat a hard sandwich that Ryan makes. But now you have these three false teeth.
Yeah, exactly, right in front.
But the thing that Dad does, though, in the mornings, he'll leave the teeth out, and then it's really weird.
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, it's really. Did you ever think you would be a man with three less teeth in your top teeth?
No. Never crossed my mind.
Now, you're out here because I bought you tickets to go see your favorite band, the Eagles, at the Forum last night. And what did you think of the Eagles concert?
It was amazing. I mean, it really, really was. And, you know,
Steely Dan.
Sometimes it's hard to pronounce.
Yeah, guys, the teeth actually do make his speech a little differently.
A little different, yeah. I don't swear as much.
It's hard to pronounce the F word. Yeah,
exactly. It's a good one. Anyway, but no, Steely Dan was the lead-in act. He could have been a show of his own, Donald Fagen.
Yeah.
I mean, it was really good. It was amazing with the Eagles and Steely Dan, how they still sound like they were in their 20s.
Yeah, they, I mean, they
back
sounded
in the 70s.
I mean, they sounded beautiful. I thought Steely Dan, like, they're two different styles of music from the 70s.
Right.
I mean, obviously the Eagles have been popular the whole way, but I've gotten so into Steely Dan over the last, like, you know, I would say 7 or 8 years. But Steely Dan, to me, is a very kind of New York cool band.
Yeah,
and
very much, yeah.
The Eagles are kind of a Los Angeles lazy cool band,
yeah,
because
really,
they write so much about taking it easy and California and Los Angeles.
Yeah, because they went to college in Bard College in New York. You know, very the Northeastern kind of a thing school.
Steely Dan, you mean?
Yeah, Steely Dan.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, anyway, but yeah. But it was really good. But it was just amazing that everybody had white hair.
Everybody had white hair. They were carding nobody at the drink station because everybody was in their 60s. I think I was the youngest person. But that's so weird to me, though, because I was raised on Eagles music because of you. So that was even, you know, and I would say, you know, when you come on the podcast, we talk a lot, of course, about Mom, but we also talk a lot about aging and how weird how weird it is. And I was thinking about that last night, especially even for myself. We were at the Forum 10 years ago. We saw the Eagles at the Forum 10 years ago, like 2 weeks
almost exactly.
Me and you went to the Eagles, so it was like a decade since, and I was looking at pictures of us that night, and we both look so much younger.
I wonder why.
Yeah, but isn't it interesting to have a band that you follow your entire life?
I mean it was just amazing. And like you say, to me it was kind of cool even just watching it. I mean, there's thousands and thousands of people there. And they're all pretty old. And then watch them, like, these women and guys dance, like, in front of you. And I'm thinking, God, that's how I look.
You look way cooler. We didn't dance together at all.
No.
It was,
not at all. It was cool.
Yeah, no, it was really awesome. And you couldn't help but, you know, get emotional about the music itself.
Very much so.
And there are certain lyrics, even in Steely Dan songs or Eagles songs, where you're like, oh, God, that... You know, that works so well about the passage of time,
or
loving somebody, or all of that. And, you know, I thought this, and I don't know if you mind, you know, me sharing this with the audience, of during Best of My Love, you were crying, you teared up.
Boy, it caught me by surprise. But I guess, you know, obviously that's how grief works. I mean, man, I was sky high, not literally yet. I mean, but you know, I was sky high. I mean, just silly dampen on one heck of a show.
Yeah.
And then the Eagles, and they do the best of my love. And then boom, all of a sudden, I was flooded with Becky, literally.
Well, see, that's what I was going to ask you. That could have been any woman. It was mom. You yep. were no, I was joking. Well, that was and I was like, I noticed, and I, you know, I put my arm around you, and
it was good,
you know. And I thought that was, but I really thought how interesting. But that isn't that how grief works though? Is like we were talking about how you think about it at weird times.
Yeah.
You'll be riding high, and then all of a sudden you'll get a thought. And it just kind of springs back.
No, it was just really weird last night. I mean, really, really caught me by surprise. And it was just so weird. And all of a sudden, I'm like, boom, what the hell's happening here? You know? And,
but isn't that is that a good thing? Or would you prefer not to have those moments?
Doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't bother me. It just happens. It happens. I miss Becky very much. I miss mom very much. And it just happens. So I'm not ashamed of it at all. And it's just what it is. But usually I don't do it in front of 15,000 people.
Yeah, but they put him on the big screen. They videoed. No. Don Henley booed him. Yeah. No.
Really.
Well, that, I mean, think about the Eagles band. You know, we've been watching them for so long. And Glenn Frey, one of the founding members of the Eagles, really. He passed away like 8 or 9 years ago. His son took over for Glenn Frey. So you had his son up there singing his songs.
And he was good.
No, yeah. He was great. You had Vince Gill, the country singer, filling in. Really he good. Was great. Yeah. But I was just thinking, why? And Don Henley, he's there. He's 76 years old.
76 years old.
All white hair.
Yeah, all white.
And I went through phases with Don Henley because of you, like the Eagles and then his solo career.
Oh, his great solo
career. I mean, End of the Innocence. Remember, he had his long hair.
That was the best album ever.
All You Want to Do Is Dance.
Yeah,
like he had a really...
End of the Innocence.
I mean, it was great. But I just thought that was interesting of following a band throughout your life. And you said last night on the way home, you said, hey... Well, hopefully we can go in 10 years from now and you'll be 85. Don Henley will be 86 and I'll be 30. So
I'll still be buying $50 t-shirts.
Yeah, but that's the other thing. When dad would initially go to concerts, yeah. I'm sure shirts were like $5.
They're like 10 bucks.
Yeah, $50 a shirt now. And drinks were, they really get money out of you.
Yeah, they get money out of you, but you don't mind.
Yeah. So we didn't get to talk over Christmas, and you know, we were with everybody, the family, and you know, we talked about Thanksgiving and how that went, and I thought, yeah. Okay, we did really good with Thanksgiving. Yeah, you know, good. I didn't know, but then I think I got cocky and thought, okay, we got Christmas, no problem at all. And then I remember about a week or two before Christmas, I started getting nervous going, oh no, we're doing this again.
Yeah.
We've got to do this again. Were you nervous at all about, we screwed up a little bit.
Oh yeah. Sorry.
Were you nervous at all?
About Christmas?
Yeah. About Christmas. I know that sounds silly, but.
No, it was really weird because, you know, it was our
production.
Major holiday,
yeah.
A big production. It was really nice. And, but yeah, I miss kind of like all the decorations that mom used to do and all that. I mean, she was really great. And, but no, so I don't know. It was kind of like bittersweet. But let me tell you this is that, yeah, I went back to Columbus right before
Christmas. Yeah, to see your mom, who is still alive, almost 100 years old.
99 years old. So I was back in Columbus like a week before Christmas. And when I went back, I decided I wasn't going to put a Christmas tree up. I just didn't want a hassle with it. And besides, I'm very lazy. And I just didn't want to do it. So I came back from Columbus, and Kara, my daughter, picked me up at the airport. So we drive home, pull in the driveway, and her husband, my son-in-law, Chris, had put the exterior holiday lights up. Really nice. It was just, oh, wow, this is nice. So anyway, so we walk in the house, and I turn the corner to come into the living area. Boom, there, the Christmas tree is up. It's decorated beautifully. very tastefully decorated around the house and everything.
None of the nudes that were usually up on Christmas. You said tastefully decorated.
Yeah, tastefully decorated. Yeah. And then my granddaughter Karen, son-in-law Chris, they were hiding around, and they come out. And It was really, and then Ryan texts me, says, are you surprised?
Well, Dad, the audience, I talked about it on the show before this even, they knew that this was happening.
Nobody told me.
Well, this was a plan. Well, we were trying to give Dad the decision if he wanted to do it or not. And then finally we were like, screw it. We're just going to do it anyway.
Well, I'm glad you did.
And it was great. It really did add so much. But at the same time, it reminded us of how much Mom did. And I thought I thought it was a show of respect to her as well.
It was all about her and everything. It really was.
Oh,
very bittersweet, you know.
Oh, you got to tell the people about the Bible. so Dad, you know, we finally cleaned out all of Mom's clothes, put them in bags. I think we had talked about that before, probably.
Oh, I'm sure.
You know, donated all of it. Really, really cool. And then Chris, my brother-in-law, he made these really beautiful built-in shelves in the closet and made it like Dad's closet. Yeah. But tell him what happened the other day.
Well, yeah. So this is really, well, let me little history first. Becky did not want to pass away at home.
Yeah.
And she told me that one night when she was still good, she told me that and everything. And, you know, so I was going to respect her wishes, even though I wanted her to die, pass at home. But anyway, so when the time came, it happened so fast that she had to pass at home.
Yeah, we risked putting her in an ambulance. She would have died in an ambulance, and we thought that was kind of inhumane. And it all happened, and the audience knows this, it all happened within a week when we thought it was going to be months.
Yeah,
it was really very quick.
Yeah, it was very quick. I mean, so I made the decision that, you know, she would pass at home. But she told Kara,
my sister,
about 2 or 3 days before, that if we didn't let her pass at home, she would come back and haunt us.
She said she told my sister she would haunt us if that didn't happen.
I mean, okay.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the other day I was in the closet and I was reaching up on a shelf to get a basket. It had some Mom's stuff in it. And I forget what I was looking for. And there was this huge study Bible on top, and it wasn't a soft cover. It was a hard. I mean, it was a friggin' book. Maybe not friggin', but it was a book. It was big. Yeah. So I lift up the thing, and the book fell and hit me where, like, a week before, I just had surgery on my forehead.
Because he had skin cancer, and he had that dug out, and then the thing hit you right on the forehead.
It hit me, and I was dazed. I'm like, where am I? Blood's coming down my face. Okay, you win, Becky.
Oh, man, she was laughing in heaven. Oh, what? Now that sounds insane. Has there been any other moments for you where you have felt the presence of Mom?
Well, at the Eagles concert.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, she flooded me.
So she just won't let you have a good time.
No, yeah.
She will not. No.
Well, it's hard to say specifically because, well, she's always there.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. You're right. I was telling the audience the other day, though, in one of the stupid Housewives show, they were talking about, I was telling you the other day, I was like, man, I'll be like laughing at these stupid things. And all of a sudden they'll talk about their mom dying. And I'm like, why are we talking about this serious stuff? But they were talking about, you know, signs from their mom, or they see a certain bird, or they see, or the dream. And that just doesn't happen for me. And I feel so sad about that it doesn't.
But it shouldn't. We all grieve. We all remember in our own ways.
No, but I want her to reach out to me. I want her to hit me with a Bible or something like that, you know?
Well, I wish you would have been there. It hurt. But we all grieve in our own ways and everything. And I get that. Now, you know, I mean, I think about Mom all the time. I mean, seriously.
Yeah.
You know, but it's never been any... You know, and I talk to her and bring her up to date on everything, keep her updated and all that good stuff. But it's just, I don't know. It's just weird.
Well, that's what I mean. A lot of the audience had reached out, and, you know, they're always wanting to know how you're doing and all that. But a lot of people will also share their experiences of, like, you know, like, oh, I'm going through this right now. And it's so, and because I know we're not, like you always say, we're not unique in this situation.
No.
We're no better. We're nowhere. Like, we're so blessed, but all
millions.
But at the same time, it's really kind of wakes you up to another side of humanity, but also deadens you in some way, because I feel like right now I'm just, even though if it might sound differently, I'm trying to put one foot in front of the other,
yeah,
you know?
It really is. And it's only been 4.5 months. I mean, which is not that long.
Well, you know what's sad when you say that? And I'm like, okay, we only have to get up to a year. But you're like, no, we have to deal with this the rest of our life. She doesn't come back in a year magically, you know? Back.
No, nope, there's no, you know, we just learn to adapt and everything. Like, for instance, I'm used, when mom first left, coming home to an empty house.
Yeah.
Really, I just hated it. It was terrible. Everything. I'm getting more used to it now. I mean, when I leave, I'm going to come back at night. I basically have every light in the house on.
Wow, you're really trying to piss her off up there. Oh, my God. If you turn on the AC, you're really going to.
Don't tell her. But I mean, now, I still leave like every light on. But I'm getting used to it. But it's so weird when I think, I'm living by myself.
That's what I was thinking about last night. We got back from the show, and then I had ordered us McDonald's, like true men. And then I was just like, well, what's this like for you then coming home from something? It's not like you would wake up mom anyways and talk to her about the concert, but
she was there.
But yeah, there was this thing of, and that was the thought I will have. And sometimes you just said, by the way, are you all right with talking about all this stuff?
Sure.
Okay, cool. I don't want to push you
absolutely.
To,
nope.
Is that you said, I'm getting used to it. I'm getting used to it. And I think sometimes I happen, and I think some of our family does happen to sometimes go to the depression side of things, or will, easily get sad or emotional. Is there something, cause to me, I hear that, or when I feel that, I get sad about that of like, well, I shouldn't have to get used to it. It shouldn't have to be a getting used. There's something sad in, well, I never want to get used to it.
And you never will.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You just learn to deal with it. It's like, like grief and everything. You just keep pushing it down, And
are we supposed to not push it down? Are we supposed to like vomit it out everywhere and see where the cards fall?
I guess it's up to us. I mean, that's how I deal with it.
Push it down?
Just push it down.
Well, how is that healthy though? And like,
it doesn't.
Yeah. I'm not telling you it's the right thing.
But at least I'm doing something.
Yeah. The pushing is an exercise in itself. Well, that's, the thing about like, so 4 months, you obviously that first month, it's so funny. People will tell me conversations I had with them that first month that I have no recollection of.
Yeah. Right.
They have no recollection. Like that I wasn't, I wasn't drinking. I wasn't blackout. I wasn't, but I'll be like, I didn't know I had that conversation with you. I didn't know. And that's kind of weird to like think about that period of time where I'm like, I remember right up until, she passed away. And then it's like, I remember, I remember saying goodbye to her when I was going to leave and you guys left me alone. And I thought I was going to go to Betches and the hospital. Like, I remember and that's kind of emotionally where I leave off.
Yeah, really.
That weird moment. But then you come out of that other side of it. And what is the most shocking thing for you besides living alone? What is it like, oh shit, I'm having to grocery shop for myself. I'm having to pay bills. You're now having to learn skills that it wasn't like you were ignoring before, but it was just mom did those.
It was just easier. She did it. She did it so good.
Now, does that part of it all scare you about, I don't want to do new shit?
Maybe not scares me. I mean, I know I have to do it, so that's not a problem. I know I have to do it. But, I wish I'd know more, and I'm slowly educating myself what's going on. It's not that big of a deal. I mean, it really isn't, but, mom handled everything.
Yes.
Yeah. Just do it my way, and we'll all be happy. Okay.
Well, that was the thing. Even up in the hospice, we were still, me and her were supposed to be doing things. Like there are a couple of bank account things. There was a couple and so we weren't planning on, we knew what was the end result was going to be, but it is interesting how, and she would be like, you see, guess what? You guys are going to be so mad. You're going to be so effed up when I'm gone.
But we're doing it.
Maybe, no, we're no, you're not, by the
maybe,
way.
I'm maybe not as neat or organized as mom did it, but it's being done.
Yeah.
And it's no big deal. Everything's under control. I know there's stuff I need to do personally as far as just internally things I need to do, and I'll do them, I'll do them and give myself some grace period, but I can only, like I told you the other day, I can only use mom as an excuse for so long. about not
doing
things.
Yeah.
You know? So, no, I'm a widower.
You can only use that. Well, that's the other thing, too, is I will say, and it does, there are small blessings within this that, you know, we all went out with, like, you know, how good Kara, my sister, your daughter, how good she did Christmas and how that would have, how mom would have been so, I mean, she would have given notes, but it would have been, she would have been so, like, I mean, we we all were in there, Rebecca, all of us, it was just so nice. And she did it so, when she's grieving as well.
Yeah, well, you too, with all the stuff you've done, you were grieving. But yet you guys both, and I've said this many times, so please forgive me, but you guys both, grieving as much as you were, took care of me. It still are.
Well, you know, but I will say, but sometimes that actually helps me to take my mind off my bullshit.
Right.
But I will say, because of a couple of things that we've talked, you know, like Christmas, you know, a couple of things other than mom really messed with me in a hard way where I was like, oh, shit. Like, I wish mom had been there. But anyways, but it is interesting to go through that. But I was also just so cognizant of how good Kara did that I was blown away by that. And then the other memory I have is that one of the last nights we were there, we all went to this, you know, some hole in the wall pizza place.
Oh, yeah. Crust. Yeah.
Crust. And this isn't, and mom, if you're listening, you shouldn't be listening to podcasts in heaven. But if you are, we all sat around and we were laughing, and it wasn't, the conversation wasn't dominated by our trauma. It was BS about the kids, my niece and nephew. And we sat there and I was really enjoying myself.
Very nice.
And that was kind of like this little ray of like hope of like, okay, you can see a future where we enjoy hanging out with each other without the cloud of mom.
Yeah. I mean, we're so blessed though that we do have our family.
Yeah.
Said that we're very blessed, you know, me especially, I'm extremely blessed. Before going any further, if I can for a minute, I want to thank several people who sent me Christmas card. However, I left the list back in Phoenix.
Okay. So you'll come on again and do that. But a lot of people sent Dad Christmas cards.
Yeah. I just want to thank you very much. Very kind words. And you know, I remember them all, read them all. And they really meant a lot. The puzzle was...
Yeah. Juliana Carosa sent you the puzzle, which is more of a mom thing.
Yeah.
But it was still really awesome.
Very nice. And also, and Kim. Hi, Kim. Love you. Thank you. Here I am waving.
He's waving to an audio mainly podcast. It's good.
I'm old. Hi, Kim. Thank you for your cards. I always love hearing from you, and I thank you very much. And all of you, thank you very much. And just thank you. You're good people.
Yeah, no, I'm so blessed to have the audience I do. Are you good for a couple more minutes? Are you still good? Are you having a good time? Are you too much? Okay.
Well, I'm having a ball.
Yeah.
No, I'm fine. I'm sure it's boring.
Dad, this is what I'm saying. I'm telling you, we might think it's boring, but I swear to God, people say this is so helpful for them. And I do think that it is helpful to talk about and for people to actually that are going through this or have gone through this, they recognize it.
And the people have written notes to me basically say the same thing. Here, let me take my teeth.
Yeah, his teeth are really
good. I'm not quite used to it. Yeah. But anyway.
I was going to say what was weird was this week we went to Costco, me and you, yesterday, which, by the way, Dad lost his iPad in his own house. He lost his iPad in his
own... losing it, guys. I mean, I'm really... seriously, I'm...
And he lost his wedding ring, but he found that.
Found my ring.
He found the ring, but he lost his iPad. We can't... And he didn't hook it up to the Find My iPhone, so we can't find it yet. But it's got to be there somewhere, and it's not that big of a house.
It has to be. You know, I know I didn't take it to Ohio with me, you know, but I still called Uncle David, and I had him check the whole house. You know, so I knew, I was pretty sure I didn't take it to Columbus, but I can't find it. And so I bought a new iPad. So when I go home, I'm sure I'm going to walk and it's going to be right there and say, hey, hi, remember me? You know? But also my ring, the iPad I can replace.
Yeah, you were distraught about that.
I can't replace my ring. This is my connection.
But guess where the ring was? It was in the jewelry box where you're supposed to keep the ring. And you lost this. It was like for weeks, and you didn't check the jewelry box.
I did. No, I checked. I checked it at least twice.
So it magically appeared.
Yeah.
Mom really is messing with you. He's slowly driving you mad again.
That's my excuse, and I'm sticking to it.
No, what I was saying, we went to Costco, and I will say that actually tripped me out for the rest of the day because I, you know, you have those things, you know, with mom. I had, like, I would always go to Costco with mom.
Yeah, exactly.
That was like, you would stay home. Yeah. I would go to Costco with mom. So me and you are now at Costco running around. But, and I was so used to getting direction from mom. I would steer the cart, or she would even sometimes even steer the cart and then tell me this, this, this. And that was a trip, because so many memories of so many Costco trips came flooding back.
Because back in Phoenix, I always, you know, I went with mom when you weren't there. You know, everything.
Okay, listen, the flooding at Costco, the member, that's my thing. That's not okay. Your thing. That is not, no.
Did I tell you about the Eagles concert?
Yeah. Well, but then I was just thinking, I mean, we were driving around Los Angeles and, you know, you were saying, oh, I remember going to this with mom, or I remember, because I've lived here 20 years. Yeah. I mean, like, you know, I remember going to this and I think that's got to be weird for both of us.
It's really weird. Yeah.
You're driving around going, oh, we went to that restaurant with mom, or we went to that thing with mom. And I thought that was another thing that I noticed, that I was like, wow, like, that's awesome. But at the same time,
life is memories.
Yeah.
But thank goodness, I love my memories.
Yeah. I mean, that's, I think I read that earlier, like, when life works best if you remember.
Yeah.
Life works best if you remember.
Thank goodness for memories.
And so then what are you getting good at, do you think, in being by yourself or being at home? Or what do you think this has opened you up to? Are you being a better friend? Are you being a better, like, has there anything been like, okay, this is actually interesting?
Well, first of all, I think I'm just getting good at living by myself.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big deal.
That is a huge deal.
A big deal. I mean, I can't say I'm a better friend. I think I'm more empathetic and I've always been pretty empathetic, but, you know, now I'm really empathetic.
Yeah.
Been there, done that.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, just to remind people that have followed your journey, they followed you on stories about Vietnam.
Oh, yeah.
They followed on stories about getting married, your brother's death. Like, they know a lot of your history. And is it sometimes so hard to, we talk about this with your mom, grandma, who's 99 years old, about being the one that is able to be here?
Well, first of all,
you're the carrier of the memories.
No, I am. Yeah. And I'm a caregiver. And everything, except when it comes to you and Kara, you guys take care of me, which was amazing. But anyway, I often thought about that, especially being the youngest in the family. But of course, if my brother Dale, Uncle Dale, was still here, he would have been the patriarch and everything. But no, it's what it is. It's there. You do it. Might as well do it, you know. It comes out of love, you know. Being with my brother on his journey, and everything, and even thinking about guys in Vietnam that didn't make it and everything, and all that. And you look at that. I look at that from an early age, you know, with my, well, which is a good thing when my father passed away, but I mean, death is a part of life, you know.
But like, I mean, death is a part
of life.
I don't
know what point I was making.
No. I mean, listen, you made so many points, but I do get like, do you, I hate to get, we've already gotten deep, but do you get scared of death? Do you get scared? And you've watched it now. We've watched it up close. You've watched, like, is there, you know, and are there things that you haven't done that you want to do?
Oh, there'll always be things. Like, mom and I had so many things planned. Mostly travel.
Yeah.
You know, and because that was, I really, really loved that. We love new places and traveling and all that, and the intimacy of it and all that. It was really cool. But no, I mean, I just want to live. I'm going to miss traveling like that. I don't see myself going to Europe by myself or South Africa. And I just wish we would have made South Africa.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. The pandemic took care of that. Thank goodness it happened before we were there.
Damn you, Fauci. I'm joking.
But I'm just rambling.
I know you think you're rambling, but actually, this is really important. And I thought it was exciting the other day. You finally started actually being able to concentrate enough to read again.
Absolutely.
No, and I'm not joking. You used to be a huge reader.
And I didn't read for like 4 months.
Which was, if you know my dad, it was, he would always had a book and you weren't able to even concentrate. And you finally, what was the first book you finished? Because I know you read the Stephen King book. But before that, you...
What was...
Was it a book on grieving or was it a...
Well, it was a book. It was... It was... what's his name, Lewis?
C.S. Lewis.
C.S. Lewis.
The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, but he also did.
Yeah, and he did a short look. His wife passed away, so he went grieving. It was basically he put in the words what everybody else goes through. And one thing, reading, it was a short little book, only 70-some pages, but, you know, a book I'll read over and over again. But one thing I've learned from him, when I didn't have to look up every word he wrote, I mean, geez, I had a dictionary next to me. Never heard of this word. But anyway, grief is universal. Here's this great man who's grieving just like we have.
Yeah.
And we're like each other. We've all grieved.
That's what connects us as people, is that we all have love. We all have lost.
I have much in common with C.S. Lewis.
Yeah. Now, and listen, since I have you here and I'm brave in front of a microphone, you know, you and Mom used to talk about, like, you know, your romance or whatever and like that. But at the same time, I don't want to glamorize anything, like, you know, like you've always said, and Mom, like, you guys have had difficulties and all that stuff. And Mom, I've known, she ruled with an iron fist. You know, she like, you know, she was very opinionated, which I, you know, all of this stuff. But would you be able to still have those moments with Mom where you would be able to break through that tough exterior? And I think sometimes even as she got older, she got tougher and very tougher.
Like her mom.
Yeah. You know, very steely. And I don't mean this negative. It's just, she really kind of even more got him more ensconced in, like, the, you know, I don't know, just very strong. And even when thinking about her death, it wasn't like she pulled each of us aside and said, this is what I want you to do with your life. This is what I, you know, we had all of these conversations. It wasn't things left unsaid, but
no,
I mean, and even when you were first meeting Mom, were you able to, like, romantic talk her? Were you able to be like, you're so beautiful? Were you able to say those things?
Yeah, Mom was easy.
Feels like another Bible. Where are the Bibles? But were you able to be romantic with her in that way where she was able to accept it?
Mom was very passionate, very giving.
No, I don't want to hear this.
Did I tell you that?
No.
No. It was towards the end, you know, just got harder. What really happened was that she excelled at her job. I mean, you know.
She
excelled. Written up and everything. She was really so good at, but she hated it. And it made her more hard.
Yeah.
I mean,
because she had to work so hard. And she was also in a male dominated
industry. She didn't have to work so hard. She worked. That was Mom.
Yeah. You know? That's true. Yeah, you're right.
We still break. In fact, you know, when it was just her and I on her journey and everything at nights, or I was sitting with her and, you know, and everything, we talked, you know, we have very soft talks and everything. We remembered.
Yeah.
We had conversations. Remember that time, you know, and
yeah,
you know, I remember when it's just part of life. I mean,
but it was interesting. In one of the final weeks when I was there, it was the three of us and her cousin, Connie. So it was me, Mom, and you, and then Connie came in and it was amazing. And set up this, or we were able to get through her Apple AirPlay. All she had put together photos of the whole family from the last 60 years, things that I didn't know. And Mom, you know, wasn't doing good, obviously, but she sat out there with us. And I'm sitting here, like, I was blown away looking at little Mom, my grandpa, looking at all this history. And Mom seemed unfazed, unaffected. And I think, you know, she was very deep in her illness at that point.
It was really, it took her a lot, because you remember, you know, how she was. I think she just gave it her all.
Even saying goodbye to Connie, she said something. She's like, well, I guess this is it. Exactly. Goodbye. And that tore me up. Was just like, damn, you know, I don't know. So the thing is, though, what I want, and by the way, every time you come on, people think this guy needs his own podcast. His son sucks compared to him.
What the?
That was the other cool thing that I wanted to bring up to tell the audience, was that last night we were at the concert and you were saying, you know, because sometimes you'll still sneak a cigarette here and there. And you said, because I want to be here for my niece and nephew, your grandkids. And speak about that, of being able to be there for them, because I do think they need you, you know?
Yeah, thanks. No, I want to. I want to, and for Becky too, because, you know, she can't, but I can be here. So I need to be here for her and I. I want to see the kids grow. I want to see them get into their 20s and see what their life's taking on and everything. And, you know, and I'm their link to the past.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the future and the past, I'm their link to the past. I'm their link to their Nana, who they love very much. And it just being a part of their life is just amazing. And it's so darn easy being a grandparent. You just give them whatever they want.
Well,
you know?
Maybe that's not exactly how you're supposed to do it. But I mean, yeah, maybe, yeah, yeah. They're like, we don't want you to leave either. Yeah, please. Exactly. Yeah.
Who says when you can't buy love?
Yeah. Well, which, by the way, our nephew, Watermelon, who you knew from the first episodes of this podcast, he just finished with his first seasonal employment job. Really cool. And he did it. He stayed with it. He did good. He made his own money.
Great,
It's wild.
So no, but it's just, you know, family's everything. And again, you know, and I just want to thank all of you. I'm still amazed that Ryan tells me that you listen to me. It kind of amazes me. I mean, I have an eagle too. I mean, just joking. I'm not trying to take over.
Yeah.
But thank you all very much. I mean, every time I talk to people about Becky's journey, friends that we haven't talked to in a while or whatever, I always talk about all the cards and everything you sent, all your kindness, your love, your generosity, your compassion. You know, and it's just, to me, it's just, we're good people. We'll get through this. We're really, really good people. We love each other.
Well, and you always say, don't hate. You always say that at the end of the things. But I will say, I mean, I feel like sometimes I think we, as a people, really love to hate. I feel like we really get off on it.
Really?
And we really, I mean, like, terrible. But I mean, I see that every day in every way. Like, how do you combat not hating when that's so much easier to do than loving?
I don't know. To me, it's easy to love. I mean, I've never been a hater, but I've been very, you know, back in the day when you, you know, I was political and, you know, and not bad, but still, I mean,
you're a communist. You can tell people.
Yeah, I was a communist and everything.
No, you were very into politics. Yeah.
Yeah. And now I hate it, you know, and I don't really hate it.
No, you just hate what it brings out in people.
Oh, it's just terrible. But we're good people. And I have extremely confident with our future. I know what my grandkids are like. All my friends and their grandkids, they raise good kids. They're raising good kids. And I'm just very optimistic and just the kindness and love. And just thank you very much. And I'll shut up and go away.
No, you didn't. Okay.
Don't hate.
You're going to shut up and go away. But I will say, though, what was your favorite song last night that the Eagles played?
Really, the Best of My Love.
Best of My Love, yeah. I mean, and what was your favorite song that Steely Dan played?
Oh, man, really? I mean, that's a good question. I mean, he was really good.
He was shockingly good. I thought I was expecting not as good from Steely Dan.
He could have been the main act.
Yeah, I mean, I would actually go see them.
Absolutely. But I can't think. I mean, I like Peg. Peg and all that. But I really like all of them. When I really started listening to him again, I was just amazed of all the songs that were hits.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've been listening to Steely Dan for the last couple of days to prep for this concert.
Right, yeah.
And it really is. And by the way, you know, when I was a kid, I remember somebody at college playing me Steely Dan.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was a pothead. And I was like, I didn't really smoke weed. And I was like, okay, buddy. And I didn't like it at all. And I'm not saying I'm a pothead now because I'm not. But I will say that music means so much more to me now. Like, I really, and the jazz elements in it, were the band elements were just amazing.
Oh, the band, just amazing, the music. I mean, really was. But you know, one thing about the music back then, in my day and everything, the words had meanings.
Yeah.
I mean, songs had meaning. I mean, Bob Seger, one of my favorites. Listen to his songs. Listen to Don Henley.
I mean, you listen to some of those lyrics and it is like, and it works from each. I'm like, I can't believe you wrote this. Well, we were peaceful, easy feeling like, we were like, these kids wrote this in their 20s and now they're in their mid 70s. But the songs actually still work from like a man looking back on his life.
Absolutely.
It was like when I, you know, that song Landslide by Fleetwood Mac,
right.
you know, it's like, it's very interesting to think of Stevie Nicks singing that as a young girl when she originally wrote that song.
Yeah.
And then to sing it now, looking back on a life, Landslide takes on this whole other meaning of, you know, really kind of beauty and stuff. And I think that's one of the beautiful things about age is that, I don't know. As I get older, it's interesting. It's trying to respect the young and the youth and their right. energy and all of that stuff. But at the same time, go like, I don't know. I guess you just have to learn to let them make mistakes. I mean, raising kids is a lot the same
way.
That's
how you do. I mean, really. I mean, it's all part of life and everything. And like I say, I want to be around to see, you know, Addison and Connor. See what they do. What do where they become? Do they get married? What, you know, I want to.
Do they become assholes?
Yeah, I know. I know. I won't. You know. Hope I just want to be around. I owe it to Becky.
Yeah, you do. No, I mean, in the best way ever.
Yeah, right.
Well, Dad, we love you. And I know he can't believe that people actually like to listen to him, but I'm like trying to tell him, I'm like, dude, we could keep going. And he's like, oh, I got to stop. But no, this is great. Thank you. Because it's not only for you, it's for the people out there that are going through the same thing. Well, you know?
And again, thank you for all your cards and everything. Very, just very nice. And it meant a lot to me. Thank you.
And keep going. If you're going through this right now, keep going. We were actually at the restaurant the other night.
Oh, yeah.
And we the hostess actually listens to this show, and I don't want to Kelly, and she came up to my dad and said, I'm so sorry about you.
It was so
and
nice.
She was going, her cousin just passed away herself. But right then and there, it's like this immediate connection of all losing people that we love. But the people that stay around, we all got to band together and actually kind of do what's right for each other and out of respect for the people that we lose.
Really, anyway.
Okay.
But hey, Kim, again, thank you very much, Kim. The reason you all know Kim's story, she's a tomato lady.
Yeah, mom and dad visited Kim and her garden years ago after she wrote to me and they were going to New Mexico, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you guys had the best day with her.
Fantastic.
And she's just the best. So
really, really good person.
So just know, even the people out there listening, they've reached out. You guys do make all the difference in the world.
You really do.
You really do. This isn't just some like kind of fly by night thing. This is a part of our lives. This really does help us get through things. So thank you. Thank you to Bill Bailey, my dad.
Love you.
Love you. Don't hate.
Don't hate. Peace.
Bye.